Welcome to You Beautiful Creation. I'm Tina Jackson, and today I have a special guest. We were recently at a women's inner healing conference that we did, and I got a chance to partner up with one of my favorite peers that from Karis Bible College. And she is the founder and great minister of, from the G220 Effect. And it's a podcast and a Bible study. And I'd like to introduce to you Danai Sanders. Danai, welcome to the You Beautiful Creation.
Thank you, Tina. It's always a pleasure to come and join you on your ministry and all that you do.
Mm-hmm. I think last time our viewers had seen you, you had really long hair and you look just as fabulous with short hair. You are just absolutely gorgeous. And that is what I call a beautiful creation in Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. She radiates the glory of God. You can see it very clearly upon her. She is just such a fantastic prophetess and just a minister of the word. And again, I'm so delighted to know you and to hear what you have to share with us today. For those of you that that were a part of the Women's Inner Healing Conference that did not get recorded correctly, we have asked Danai to come on and to try to reshare what was taught in that episode, in that conference, so that we don't miss out on this beautiful teaching of what she had. So with that, Danai, I am just going to turn over the whole presentation to you for the next 25 minutes. I'm going to get out of the picture and you can share what the Lord had put on your heart for the body of Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So you guys are going to see me in a little small part. I'm going to go ahead and just share my screen real quick, and we will just begin with this presentation I have. It just helps when the slides are on the screen here and we can look at it together. I just want to start off just by saying thank you, Tina. It was such an awesome event just to be around women of faith. It's always a blessing when we come together. There's power when we come together. So the topic that I focused on during the event was talking about the enemy against our heart. It was an inner healing event that was brought about by Tina through a conference that you held. That was a health conference that led to a prayer for inner healing. And you felt the need that there's a lot of people that feel broken, and you can be born again. You can be saved. You can be filled with the Holy Ghost, but still have this grief and this brokenness that's within. So I just wanted to touch on what is the enemy against our heart, that thing that causes us to feel broken. Again, I'm Danai Sanders, and I'm part of the G220 Effect Ministry. Me and my partner in crime here, Steve, we have a ministry that we have. It started out as a podcast where we still have a podcast where we just discuss different issues that the Holy Spirit brings about in our hearts. And we discuss those on our podcast, have fun with those. But we also have a Bible study where we go in depth with the things that we talk about on the podcast and really study precept by precept, line by line. And it's such a blessing. So you'll always see us two together. but since this is a women's inner healing event, here I am on behalf of our ministry, just talking on just feeling broken and the enemy that's really against our heart. So in the conference, in the inner healing event, we talked about, I just asked and did a popcorn kind of like question and just heard what everybody had to say. But there was so much more that was said outside of these things, that what makes you feel broken? What are some of the things that causes us to feel broken or as a result of being broken? And these are some of the things. So unforgiveness, rejection, loss, sexual assault, depression, chronic illness, low self-esteem, miscarriage, abandonment, abortion, infertility, death of a loved one, that kind of grief that you have. All these things can have us in that state of feeling broken, loss of even friendships, things. I mean, there's so much that has us feeling crushed in our spirit, or we feel so broken and feel like there's a part of us that's just not whole and that's not well. So in that, we talk so much about what is the root of that brokenness, because as long as we find out what the root is, then we can take that root out, and we know that once the bad seed that's in there gets taken out, then everything will flourish well, right? So we want to get down to really understand what is the root of brokenness, because the root of brokenness is the condition of our heart. What is in our heart? Just like a tree, we know that the health of a tree is going to be based on its roots. So what is in our root system that's causing us to feel this brokenness? And it's usually what the condition of our heart is reflecting. So here in Luke 6:45, it says, the good person out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth what is good. And the evil person out of the evil treasure brings forth what is evil, for his mouth speaks from that which fills his heart. So what is coming out of us is based on what is showing in our heart, basically. So this is just the scripture to base that on, that our root system has to be healthy in order for us to see good things flowing out of our heart. So here's a little contrast, and I love contrast because even the kingdom of God, we know that there's the kingdom of God and there's the kingdom of darkness. We know that one represents light, one represents darkness. One is love, one is everything that is opposed to love, and so on and so forth. And I just love, even if you read 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, Apostle John does a good job of just giving us what those contrasts look like. So us, as we live our life in Christ, it is always so important for us to remember that we have a real enemy against us, and he's doing the opposite of exactly what God is doing in us and through us. So here on the left side, we see brokenness. Where does this brokenness stem from? So we're going to visit some scriptures, and we're going to go to Genesis 6, verses 3 and 5. So it says in verse 3, then the Lord said, my spirit will not remain with man forever, because he is also flesh. Nevertheless, his days shall be 120 years. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of mankind was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of their heart was only evil continually. So I wanted to touch on verse 3, and we're going to keep our finger on that part of the scripture, because there's something that's really important there. It says, because he is also flesh, right? We're going to keep our finger on that. We're going to revisit that as we continue to just share more. But what's important to know here is that the man's heart, what was it? Is it every intent of the thoughts of their hearts was continually evil? So we know what happened to get us to this point, right? We know that we disobeyed God, and we got to this point, and then this is the result and the consequence of what happened after we disobeyed God, is that now we start to focus on me, and what I think. I became my own God, what I wanted to do, and that moved us away from God's perfect will for us. So what happened as a result? Our hearts continue to think of evil, and this, I mean, if you read Genesis 6, 5, 6, it's so beautiful to see how wicked we were in our thought and our intent, that we got to a place where, man, God had to, I'm just gonna, you know what, let me just try to do a do-over here, because what I see is so evil in our hearts. So this is the root. This is the root that we're talking about. And we also see in Jeremiah 17, verse 9, it says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? So this is the heart of man. Before we are born again, before we choose to die to our old selves and renew ourselves in Christ, this is the condition of our heart. And this is why some people can say, I'm a believer, but still have that brokenness. Because guess what? We had this point of a divided heart. And if we're not aware, and we don't have the understanding and the knowledge of who we are now in Christ, then we can remain in the state of brokenness and never really receive all that God has for us. And that is, on the right side, how God wants our heart to be, which is being made whole in him, in Christ. So in Ezekiel 26, verse 36, it says, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. I just love this. This is so beautiful. This was his plan for us, that I will put in you a new heart and I'll give you a new spirit. So you don't have to deal with that brokenness and that continual of evil and intent of your heart always being wicked and deceitful. But now I'll give you my heart. I'll take away that stony heart, because that deceitful heart, that evil heart, guess what it is? It's stony. It's hard. It's hard. It has hardness against the things of God. And he says, I'll give you a heart of flesh. And I just took the liberty of writing a few words to me that came in my heart, meaning if your heart is of flesh, you're free. It's your heart is pliable. God can allow you, if you allow the Holy Spirit, can do so many things in your heart to make you conform you into the image of Christ. And you're pure. There's also purity that comes with a fleshly heart rather than a heart that is hard and stony. So that's just kind of the foundation, but we're going to go in and let's just read a scripture that it's going to help kind of bring things to life as we read it. So we're going to go ahead and read out of John 4. So if you have your Bibles, feel free to follow along. I'm going to be reading out of King James Version. So it might be a little different from your version if you're reading something different, but let's just try to follow along as much as possible. So I'll be looking down at my Bible, but I'm still here. just follow along with me. So this story is a passage of the woman at the well. I'm sure some of you are very familiar with this scripture. So as we go on, we're going to just talk and stop and chat a little bit as we go. I'm going to start off with verse five. I'll start off around verse five. So John 4, verse 5, it says, then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. So who are we talking about here? We're talking about Jesus, just to set the context, because we didn't read verses 1-4. It says, now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. So it was just Jesus and this woman at the well. The Samaritan woman at the well. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. So here she's saying, you're asking me for water? You're a Jew and you have no dealings with me. So what these Samaritans were known to be, not for just my terms, not pure. Right? Not pure. So you're asking me, I'm not pure. I can't give you water. You are a Jew. You are, in our society, you are known as, you know, the best and the cream of the crop. And, you know, I'm not pure. I can't give you this water. Right. So then it goes on to say, Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knowest, we're already getting to the good part. If thou knowest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. So what is this gift of God? He says, if thou knewest the gift of God, right? If you knew the good news, Jesus, the gospel, the good news that sets us free, if you knew that this is what I was about to give you, I mean, you will be amazed. But here he is. She is speaking very naturally in this. At this point, she's speaking very naturally. She's talking about societal differences. She's talking about cultural differences, religious differences. She's talking about really water, natural water. But we're going to continue, as we continue to read, we'll see how Jesus is making things spiritual. And he says, the woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? So here she's talking about her history and what she knows. Still, we're speaking very natural. Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. right? If you're talking about this natural thing, you drink this water that you're talking about that's natural, you're going to thirst again, right? And this is the difference between our spirit and our flesh. And our flesh desires the things that are temporal. Then Jesus is making an exact example of that. If you drink of this water, guess what? I can drink water right now, go out and eat something salty. Guess what? I'm thirsty again. It's temporary. But he's saying that if I give you this water to drink, and he says, okay, let me, I'm getting ahead of myself, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. So guess what? I have the water that's going to make you never to never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. So he is promising living water. Living water has the power to bring life into any dead situation. And this is the water that Jesus is promising her, that if I give you this water, guess what? You will never thirst anymore. And not only will you never thirst anymore, but you will continue. It's because you will continually have it flowing out of you in abundance to make anything that's dead come to life again. So verse 15, the woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water. Wise choice for the Samaritan woman. Give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. I don't want to ever to have to come back. If I can be good for life, I want that. So that was a wise choice on her part. Jesus saith unto her, go, call thy husband and come hither. And the woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that saith thou truly. The woman saith unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. And I wonder why she's wondering that. Okay, how do you know that I've had five husbands? How do you know my life? How do you know all these things? So Jesus is giving her what? A word of knowledge, right? So here, I just really want to point out that the things that are happening here are very spiritual, right? And by spiritual, I mean that we know that when we are now in Christ, our spirit becomes, we become alive in our spirit man. And this is the part that a lot of us, when we say I'm born again or I'm saved, we are missing that understanding that you truly have become alive in the spirit. So the things that are natural no longer serve you or have a real substantial purpose for you. The meat that you should now partake of should be the things that are spiritual. And this is what he's showing her, the things of the spirit. So I can see more than what is natural that this is what's going on with you. So the woman saith unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men are to worship. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. So again, she's talking about things that she's always done, tradition, right? And we can sometimes get caught up in tradition. How does that even connect to the issues of the heart? Sometimes tradition teaches us to keep a hardness of the heart. You know, you are to be a strong woman, you know, and then you have a stony heart because tradition told you that this is how you're supposed to be. My grandmother was like this and my great grandmother was like this. So I'm going to continue to be like this. And because what? That's tradition. And we know what the word says about tradition. It nullifies every promise that we have because you now base things on people rather than what God has spoken or what his perfect will is for you. So then he goes on to say, ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit. God is a spirit. God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So for you as a believer, and this is what G220 Effect is all about. We know that we were given just this ability to make things more about relationship, because that's what it's all about. I know that every one of us have been called to different things, but we know for sure that the Lord has called us to remind people that relationship is so important with him. And this is what it's all about. When we understand who we're in relationship with, that he is a spirit. And in order for us to relate to him, we must relate to him in spirit and not in our flesh. So many times we want to take our flesh and try to compare it to what God says, rather than take what's in the spirit and allow it to change who we are, even in the flesh, right? And that's how it's supposed to be. And that's why I wanted us to put our finger on that. Genesis 6, verse 3, because God always had a plan for us to take us out of that fleshly way of being and the result and the consequences of our disobedience to now putting us in his light and his truth. So here it says, God is a spirit, and they that shall worship him in spirit and in truth. And the same applies to us, is that now we are in a place where we should walk. We say this over and over in our podcasts and our Bible studies. We can't say it enough. We need to walk in the spirit and not in our flesh, because everything that's out of our flesh reaps corruption. And a lot of that, those things that we talked about in the beginning, I'm going to go back to that slide real quick. A lot of these things that we talked about in the beginning, a lot of this is fleshly. It's fleshly. And sometimes it's a result of our flesh, allowing our flesh to lead us in the sometimes these things come out as a result. But here we are being told that in order to walk in relationship and understand God's perfect will for us and to be set at liberty, we need to know that we are a spirit being and to relate to our God in the spirit. So we have great news. We have awesome news. Luke 4, 18 through 19, and you can read over that. But I just want to touch on this spot where it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. This is Jesus speaking, even though he's quoting something that was spoken by the prophets, but he is now speaking of himself. It says, to preach the gospel to the poor, he has sent me to heal the broken hearted. This is the promise that he wants to heal our broken hearts. He wants to make us whole in him. And we have that promise. But then how do we inherit this promise? We inherit this promise by understanding that we are now a spirit being and we need to walk in the spirit and not in our flesh. God's grace through Christ is to give you all that you need pertaining to this life and godliness. That's his grace through Christ, to give you everything that you need to be empowered to walk in the spirit, to overcome your flesh, to overcome the things that the flesh tends to bring forth in your life. So this is Proverbs 4:23. It says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issues of life. So how do we do that? By walking in the spirit. We have been empowered to be able to keep our heart with all diligence so that everything that comes out of our heart, the issues of life come out as just pure gold for us. So we have help. And I gave this a slide to just say, we have help. John 14, 15, 16 continues to talk. Jesus is just reminding us that we have the Holy Spirit. He's our helper. He will teach you all things that you need to know. He'll bring back to remembrance all things that I've taught you. So every word, every promise of his, he'll bring it to remembrance. He'll help you. He will teach you what truth is. Because you know what? Half of the time, what we think is truth is not truth. Like I said, sometimes we think because of our traditions, this is my truth because of my tradition, but it's nowhere near the truth, nowhere near what the real truth is. My husband and I use this as an example all the time, that you can look at somebody in the car and you see them going, you know, and they're so dramatic with their hands. And you're like, oh, they must be fighting. There must be something going on over there. But maybe that's not even the truth. The person is just animated in their hands. And that's not necessarily the truth. And so is it for us. There's so many things that we hold dear that are not the truth, but because our grandmother did it, or because this is how I was raised, and this is what went on in my life, this is my experience, it tends to be our truth. But the Holy Spirit will lead you to truth. He is the truth, the Spirit of truth, and He's going to lead you exactly where you need to be. So these are just some of the things that I just wanted to point out, that when you now are walking in the Spirit, guess what that's going to flow out of you? Love. And love brings forth joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And these are the fruits of the Spirit. And some of us might be very familiar with this. These are a result of the condition of our heart. Now, if we allow that area of our lives to be healed and to allow that wholeness and the healing to happen in our hearts, this is what's going to come forth of our hearts. Instead of me being angry and bitter, guess what's going to come out? I'm going to be patient, and I'm going to have joy, and I'm going to have self-control. When I want to tell somebody something about themselves because I feel that way in my flesh, my spirit is going to say, but the Lord loves that person, and you have patience with that person. You have self-control. You don't have to speak that, because when you speak that, that's going to just allow that person and validate all that's going on with that person. So I can say a lot more about this, but if you visit our podcast, we have a lot that talks about the fruits of the Spirit, and we actually break down each fruit. So you have this as a result of allowing yourself to walk in the Spirit. And I always say, in order for these promises to become true for you, these promises, you inherit them by faith. So you just have to believe that it's in you, and you will see the fruit just flowing out of you. And one thing that I know we prayed about before we did this event was, Lord, what is a word that I can give for these women to hold on to as they continue to walk in the Spirit? It's just choose life. Choose. Amen. It's a choice you have to make. Amen. Choose life and have life more abundantly. John 10:10. Amen. It's been promised to you. So walk in it and embrace it every step of the way. Again, you can visit our podcast. Some of these things are even in detail on the podcast, but I'll give it over back to you, Tina.
Well, that was so awesome and so powerful. And it was a wonderful conference, and we look forward to even doing some more in the future. I know a lot of the ladies really were inspired and got deliverance and really got a lot of good insight from your teaching. And so it was a really great time. So if we could just take like a quick, 30 seconds, can you pray for our viewers and just do a little quick prayer?
Amen. Father, we thank you so much that you are so good. Our Father is a good Father. You are such a good Father. You love us so much that even in the midst of us being lost and feeling broken, you already gave us a remedy. And all we have to do is by faith believe that everything that you've given us, every promise through Christ Jesus we have, it's yes and it's amen to us. So Lord, I pray for everyone who, like that first screen, who's going through certain things in their life and they feel broken, to remember that you have given us wholeness, that you gave us and replaced a stony heart and gave us a heart of flesh, so that we can receive all these things that you have given us, that we don't have to walk in brokenness, but we can choose life and have it more abundantly. And we thank you for these things that you have given us, and we receive them in faith in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. And Danai, how can people get a hold of you, and how can they find you on their podcast?
So we are on Apple Podcasts, we're on Spotify, we're on YouTube, we're on Facebook, Instagram. It's G220EFFECT, G220 Effect. And we also have a website, G220Effect.com. You can visit us there, and you can see a link to our Bible study also if you want to join us.
Amen and amen. Well, thank you so much for joining today. And I am Tina Jackson.
And I'm Danai Sanders.
And you are a beautiful creation in Christ Jesus. Amen. Thanks for joining us today. Be sure to like, subscribe, and share. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.